Our goal for today is to talk about distance. Now, it's easy to talk about the distance between two points if we say, well, what's the straight line distance? Or you might hear the phrase, as the crow flies. But then, of course, you might say, well, maybe I can't go in a direct line from here to there. Maybe I have to sort of move around. And now, how do you find the distance? Well, you could phrase the question as, what's the total length? And whenever you see a question that's phrased as, what's the total of something? Integration. And so, time to do some calculus. Let's begin. So our goal is really talking about arc length. And as we say, look, if I just want to go directly from one point to another, no problem. Life is good. Because there's a distance formula. When we talk about the distance, it's the straight line segment. If you want to be very fancy, you might hear the phrase geodesic, which just merely says, go in the straightest possible direction. And we know the distance between two points, the square root of x1 minus x0 squared plus y1 minus y0 squared. Good. Problem solved. Well, sure, problem solved if we have a straight line. But what if we don't have a straight line? Well, okay, what do you do for a curve like this? Well, what would you want to do conceptually? Well, you might say, look, here's a curve. What we'd like to do is just say, hey, let's straighten it out and make it into a nice line. And then life is good. Now, we're going to actually try to do that. Not so much that we're going to try to straighten it out, but we're going to say, hey, wouldn't it be great to use the idea of straight lines, to treat it like it were a straight line? So here's the idea, the basic approach. What we do is we're going to take our curve and we're going to break it into lots of little pieces. And so what we've done here, you should think of it as we want to start here at x equals a. We want to end here at x equals b. And so we're subdividing our interval from a to b into parts. And then we're saying, okay, let's look at the value of the function above those parts. Now, instead of having a curve go along, let's just say, look, let's make everything flat. We like flat things. That's one of the goals in calculus. How can we make things flat? So, in this case, instead of saying, look, instead of the curve, straight line, straight line, straight line. And what you get is, well, if you don't have very many points, you get kind of a okay approximation. But if you increase the points, not even by that many, you'll notice that the straight line segments are becoming better and better at mimicking the function. Indeed, as long as we have a reasonable function, we'll see that as we increase the number of segments, the difference between the straight line version, where we go between some number of points, versus just the original curve, it becomes indistinguishable. So that's the idea. And that's what this is saying here. Look, we break things into small little parts, it becomes a good approximation. And now, what's the whole idea? Look, we know how to find straight lines. So now we'll say, we'll add lots of individual straight line segments up, find those lengths, get a total, and that's a good total estimate. Okay, great. And of course, smaller and smaller pieces, better and better estimate. So, here we go. Where does this become? Well, we got to get a handle on what's happening between two consecutive points. So, this is a little bit, let's look at the notation. Let's be careful here. So, the subscript I just says, we want to label the point. So the subscript I means the ith point. So maybe it's the 15th point or the 127th point or something. It's just the some point. So you have xi f of xi. So that's like this point. And then xi plus 1 f of xi plus 1 would be the next point. So we start by saying, let's figure out what's happening between two points. So here we go. We look, we say, well, the distance formula says, you take the square root of change in x squared, change in y squared added up. Okay, good. Pythagorean theorem. Yeah, it's all good. It's all good, right? Now, here's the thing. When we're thinking about applying integration, we always sort of say, well, we're looking for a small perturbation. And we're thinking there should be something that represents the small perturbation. And for us, the small perturbation is the change in the input. So we're thinking as, okay, the change in the input, that's like our delta x. Well, that's happening right here. We want to have that delta x show up somewhere in our equation, so we're going to put it out at the end. And so you'll see we factored it out. So now it's moved out to the very end. So when we pull it out, well, we pulled it out completely, so that's a 1. You might say, well, wait, it wasn't there to begin with. Okay, we can solve that. We divide. You'll see this xi plus 1 minus xi squared compensates for us factoring all this delta xi out. You can run it backwards. Now, what do you see here? Well, this is the key idea. What you have is you have change in f, change in x, change in output over change in input, and it's a very small change. Well, that says this piece here acts like the derivative. So we can say, lo and behold, this is the square root of 1 plus the derivative. Now, technically, I have an equal sign. I should say it's an approximation here because it's not quite the derivative. See, there's an approximation there. But it's a really good approximation if we're really small. In other words, we've chopped up our points so they're very close to each other. So what we can now say is, hey, there's a nice expression for the length of the line segment between two consecutive points. It's this square root of 1 plus the derivative at your point squared times the change in x. All right, good. Now that's one piece. We have to add them all up. So we say, okay, add all of the pieces up. So that's what this notation means, adding up over all of them, sum over I, the length of each individual piece. Now, the way integration works is, okay, so you say, okay, in the limit, what's happening? Well, the sum becomes the integral. Integration is about adding up. And if we're summing up over all I, well, we're summing up over all our pieces, and our pieces started at A and ended at B. So we went from A to B. So that's why we get an integral A to B. This small change in x becomes our dx, and this square root of 1 plus f prime of x squared, that's our piece that tells us our length. Well, technically, we have to be careful here. In some sense, this whole part, this is a small length, including the dx. This will be important as we go forward with a few more applications in future sessions. So it's a small length, adding the small length together. Now, a few notes. We've written everything in terms of x. Nothing sacred about x. We could turn everything sideways. And we could say, well, suppose we have x as a function of y. Same process. Same process. We just throw different symbols in. No problem. Now, the basic idea is not so bad. It's like, okay, you have to integrate this expression, the square root of 1 plus f prime squared. What's the catch? The big catch here is that you have a square root. Now you might say that doesn't sound like a very big catch. However, there's a detail. A lot of people make the mistake in saying, hey, square roots aren't that bad. Look, the square root of 1 plus something squared, shouldn't that just be 1 plus f prime? And the answer is no, no, definitely not. No. So square roots are tricky. This does not work. So you cannot just simply get rid of a square root in some easy way. So you might say, okay, is there a way to get rid of a square root in a non-easy way? And the answer is not really. You have to respect the square root. But you can look for certain things. One of the big things that you'll look for is you say, well, maybe I have something on the inside that's a square. And if you do, life is good. You can make progress. Or maybe you can say, look, maybe I can factor something out of it that's common and pull it all the way out in front. Okay, that can happen as well. But also maybe it's the case that you'll set up a problem and you just can't do it. And I know you're feeling like, well, calculus, we can do anything. Yeah, you can do a lot, but not everything. There's a lot of integration problems that cannot be solved explicitly by finding antiderivatives. It turns out that's very hard. We can't always get a good numerical answer, and that involves something called numerical integration, which we'll talk about in some future session. But for now, sometimes we may just have to be satisfied with, well, at least we can set it up. At least we know this expression gives us the answer. Of course, to do all this, we should talk about practice. So let's go and start doing some practice. See you soon.